So the idea of networking in the American sense is bollocks.
Yeah.
Networking is not networking. It's living, breathing in the space that you do. And through doing it, you meet others who are equally ambitious doing it. And then one day, they become your peers and you do not realize that you've networked because they're just some guy who drank beer with you till 4 a.m.
All right, good morning, folks. Welcome to Renman Music and Business.com. My name is Steve Rennie, and I am the Renman, and this little program is called Renman Live. Hey, if you're looking to do something great in the music business, but you need a little help, you've definitely come to the right place. Our guest today is Nick Raphael, who's the president of Capitol Records in the UK, who's going to take you behind the wizard's curtain and talk about what it takes to make it in today's music business. But before we do that, let me introduce you to our wonderful and talented and low-paid Ren Management Live team here. Okay, on the keyboards over there, with that handsome young man, his name is Cody Ramos. He's the Trojan Man.
Choo!
That's right. To his right, oh, the phone is already ringing.
Already.
Gotta love it. To his right, the lovely and talented, don't let that smile fool you. We call her Killer Kira O'Neill. And she will be presiding over the chat room and the telephone,
correct,
folks. So be on your best behavior. She's got a very quick trigger over there. I'll warn you ahead of time. Not visible in the room, but whose presence is felt all over the Renman Network. He's our wizard of social media. His name is Joseph Pepelonius Pepe, and he's somewhere down in the lowlands of South Carolina, I hope. Maybe he's out playing golf again, Cody. Any word on that?
I think he might be practicing.
He might be practicing. And by the way, that's not a bad thing. Let me tell you something about our little website and show. What makes our show unique is that we're talking with the smartest people around, as I mentioned, but we want you to be part of the conversation. Today, believe it or not, is our 106th webcast with some of those smart folks. And we got a saying around here at the world headquarters: you don't ask, you don't get, and you don't ask, learn anything, folks. So today's your chance to talk to one of the titans of the business. Today would not be a great day to be shy. And to encourage you in that regard, I have the lovely Kira O'Neill is going to tell you how you can be a part of the show and ask some questions. Take it away, Kira.
All right, so you can go to RenmanMB.com, become a member, and you can post your questions on the event page ahead of time. Or right now, I'll be checking it
go
still.
Go slow, Cody's trying to tell the story here, Kira.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. There's our lovely website, now the event page.
And I'll be presiding over the chat room, so if you have any links that you want to share, any graphics, etc., you can do hashtag RenmanLive, and that'll hit the Twitter feed as well as our crowd surfing chat room. And the last thing you can do is call in, which we have a hotline, and it's ringing off the hook here.
What do they get, Kira?
They get,
if they are bold,
if they're
bold
really, if they're really bold, they're gonna get this shirt. I don't care if they're soft or not, but I want the fuck the gatekeepers.
Fuck the gatekeepers.
This is a good shirt.
That
to
is,
own.
By the way, folks, that's not some 70 porn star. That's me when I was just dreaming, and before I started doing, when I had hair and a mustache, and was fueled with enthusiasm. Maybe it's lacking a little bit.
All right.
Okay, we got, boy, it's a mess over there
it's
today.
Crazy.
They're all calling. Okay, they're taking this to heed. You got a chance to get in the room with the president. Okay, if you're not lucky enough to call in, you can also purchase that fine merchandise. Can you show them the graphic there, Cud? Let's take care and pay some bills. All right, that wonderful coffee mug, T-shirts and all. We're going to be adding some more items to the mix as well. And so this way, my friend, they're all coming in here today. This has got a sold out show here today, Kira. Okay, that's it for all the business of the day. Okay, so let's talk to, I know why you're all here, so let's get down to it. One of the things I hear most often from aspiring artists and professionals looking to do something in this music business is that it's nearly impossible, they tell me, to connect with real decision makers in this business. If that's been a problem for you, today is going to be your lucky day. So for any of our viewers out there who ever complained about it, stop complaining and call in on that phone. Our guest today is and has been one of the top A&R star execs in the music industry for years now. He's been honored twice with the prestigious A&R Award by Music Week magazine in the UK. He's worked for or run some of the top labels in the business, including Sony, BMG, and is now with UMG. In addition to founding his own label called Northside Record, over his 20-plus year career in the music business, he signed some hugely successful artists, the likes of Jay-Z, and most recently, Sam Smith and 5 Seconds of Summer. Both of them, if you've been under a tree, are multi-million album-selling acts and are top of the business. He's currently serving as the president of Capitol Records in the UK. He's here today to take you behind that wizard's curtain of the label world and help you understand what you're really up against. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please welcome my good friend, Mr. Nick Raphael. How you doing,
I'm Nick? Good, thank you.
Well, first off, Nick, let me be polite and thank you for taking the time out of your schedule to come on the show today. You're in town for an A&R conference, right?
I am in town for an A&R conference and meetings with Capitol Records because we're setting up the 5 Seconds Summer follow-up album, which is coming this year. And it was an honor to be on here because I've seen some of the very prestigious guests who are way more seasoned and way more deserving of the nice things you said about me, who I've watched many of them, including some of my very, very dear friends, including Mr. Griffiths.
We will chat about Richard a little bit later today. The folks that watch our show are typically aspiring artists and professionals that are looking to do something big in the business. And we know how difficult it is to get started in this business. And I think sometimes people think there's a magical checklist, whether I'm going to go to college and get a music business degree, or it's just about knowing the right person or being at the right place at the right time. But the fact is that there are as many different paths for successful people getting into the business as there were successful people. So my first question, I'll ask you the same thing I've asked everybody. What is it that motivated you, A, initially to get into the music business, and B, how did you actually get your way into this crazy business, Mr. Raphael?
The reason I got into the music business was as base as it possibly can be. My reason to get in the music business was I failed as a professional soccer player. I went all the way to the age of 19 to become a professional soccer player. I played for a club called Bradford City, which was in the second tier of British professional football. They offered me a contract. I realized that I wasn't going to make the top grade. And I was a very ambitious human being. And I thought to myself, I don't want to be in the second tier. I'm either going to be the David Beckham or the Messi or Cristiano Ronaldo, or give up. And I had no chance in soccer of hitting serious levels of success. I could have earned a living and a very conservative living. I then went to university to do economics. And I used to go out with all my pals to nightclubs. And I used to queue like everybody else to get in. And you went to nightclubs to meet chicks, girls. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I hate to be base. I hate to say any women out there think I'm sexist. I wanted to have sex with girls. I was a 19-year-old boy. When I looked in the club, the hottest girls were, first of all, with the DJs. And I was like, but that DJ, he's an ugly mofo, right?
You can say motherfucker on the show, by the way.
Okay, yeah. He's an ugly motherfucker. Yeah. And I can't get near that girl. So I thought to myself, shit, I need to become a DJ. But then, later in the evening, I realized the hottest of the hottest girls were with the guy who I didn't recognize at all. And I said to my pal, who's that doing? He says, it's his night. He's the promoter. I was like, yo, the promoter. He gets the A-list hookups, and he's even uglier than the DJ. So I thought to myself, I need to get in on this action. Mm-hmm. So I became a promoter, ended up running a nightclub. And I met incredible girls. It was totally based. It wasn't about money. It wasn't about anything else. I had a huge love of music. I always did. My parents were really into music. But my core reason for getting in the first place was if there was levels of girls that you could get when you looked like me, I needed to step a level up. You know, can you imagine if you're a Hollywood actor, you might not even be the best looking guy in your town. But the minute you're in a movie, every chick wants to date you.
Yeah.
But when you were, and I was in a northern town in England, going to university, Leeds, a beautiful city. And, you know, I was probably the average guy who'd get the average girl. Mm-hmm. But obviously, like everyone else, I want to date the hottest girl in the world because like everybody else, that's the dream, isn't it? And so I
pretty
ran.
Girls need love.
Oh no, 100%, 100%. By the way, I found the prettiest girl in the world. So and I've stayed in love with her and still in love with her 23 years later.
She might be a little disappointed in this story here.
No, she won't. She won't be. She won't, because trust me, I met her in that environment, and I've been a lovely, honest, wonderful husband. I hope that's my version of events. Anyway, in between,
call her later and ask. Okay.
But the truth was, the reason I got into music was actually not about music per se at the beginning. My love for music was, I went to nightclubs, I went to shows, I'd seen The Cure live, I'd seen The Stranglers live, I'd seen Simply Red live, if you think, you want to get down on my music taste. Yeah. But I love music, I love going to concerts, I went with my friends. When the DJ housing, which you call EDM in America now, was massive 25 years ago, I was down with that music. It was the most exciting thing. It was the most exciting music, the most exciting drugs. It was the craziest time in life. And I was 19, and at 19, you want to get hooked up. But then I started doing the promoting and the nightclub thing, and then I didn't have a DJ, so I became a DJ as well. So I got double looks.
Cheaper that way.
Yeah, but actually wasn't my motive. The truth was, I couldn't get people to play the stuff we wanted them to play. So we played it. We played our own music, and there was the economic side of it as well at the beginning. And then we became named DJs, so we could fill other people's nightclubs because our club became so successful. And I was like, shit, I'm actually good at this crap, right? Yeah. As opposed to, I'm now just trying to get girls. I'm actually making a really good living. And I love this stuff.
So let me ask you then. So it's interesting because that's a great segue too. You know, at some point, a lot of people start with some passion. You're not the only person that figured out, hey, you know, that this I want to be that person, right? But at some point, it starts to go from a whisper to a scream, and you start to think, okay, this isn't just about shagging women, and getting, through the line at a club. This is something I might actually do for a living. When did you start to get that clear idea that, you know what, this maybe is my calling in life? Was there a moment when that kind of clicked in here, when you got past that initial, ulterior motive?
It's a weird thing to say. I went into it with my the honesty I've just given you about why. And then it wasn't like a click moment. It's just one day, it was like, everyone knew me as the promoter. Everyone knew me as the DJ. And then I realized that I'd gone from hugely in debt as a student. I mean, ridiculously in debt. I was working in pizza parlors and trying to earn a living that way. To all of a sudden, I wasn't in debt. I was still living in like a shared condo, as you call, with all other students. And I was like, but I had wadges of cash. I was taking all my friends to restaurants and hanging out, because that's what I wanted to do. But I'd pay for them all because none of them had any money. And I was traveling the world, and I suddenly thought, shit, if this is how you can earn money, this is way more interesting than finishing my economics degree and going to the city, or finish my economics degree and become an accountant or doing something like that. So my attitude was, well, this is cool, and I'm earning more money than guys who've been 20 years as an accountant. And I'm never going to, and by the way, the idea, the dream is to be on stage and play to, tens of thousands of people. And I'm never going to be able to do it because I never took the time out to learn an instrument. I'm obviously passionate about music because I was collecting records for years. I was doing stuff. And all of a sudden, I used to make mixtapes for my friends and family. I'd make a mixtape for my mum and dad using their record collection. I'd make a mixtape for my sister to show her the music. I'd make mixtapes for kids at school who were into goth music and like The Cult and stuff like that. And I'd find music in any genre, the songs I liked, and make a mixtape for everyone. And I thought that was just like how you made friendships.
Sure.
That was my introduction to friendships. And all of a sudden, as a DJ, you're doing it on the night in front of everyone. And you spend the whole week grabbing songs and thinking, well, that one could be the one, a new one I'm going to introduce these people to. But make sure I play a load of songs they already know so they love me and they trust my judgment.
Sure.
Finding that trust bit. And all of a sudden, I was like, and I was so passionate about it. And I was sitting there thinking, wow, people are paying me this much money to do the thing I love. Can you imagine, love golf. I know you've just shown me outside your golf set up. But if someone turned around and said they're going to pay you, and I'm 19 years old, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, right, to play records or play golf, you go,
Where do I sign up? Exactly. Where do I sign? It's funny. I started as a concert promoter as well, and and similar kind of thing where I saw the Rolling Stones the first time, and that kind of got me excited about it, you know. And then I saw this guy, Peter Rudge, who was coming out, and everybody was coming up to him, right? And that was my first little moment of being a music passionate fan and thinking, I want to be that guy. And then ultimately I became a promoter, because the next best thing to sitting on that stage with 10,000 people is being the guy throwing the party. But that said, you didn't stay with promoting. You wound up getting a job in the label businesses, which is where you've made your mark.
But I never wanted a job. Now, I'll be very clear about that. I really didn't want a job. I love my independence. I love the fact that I earned more money than a label president at 19 and 20 than a label president was earning then, because I now know what they were earning. And I was earning more money and had no boss, doing my own thing, had a DJ partner, a guy called Paul Fry, who was a brilliant man, and I had a female partner called Susie Mason, and we ran this club together, and then Paul and I went around the world DJing, and we loved all that stuff. And then I met my now wife and my girlfriend of 23 years and my wife of, like, whatever now, 22 years, 1993, and I fell in lust with her like crazy. I think the love bit came as we grew, and she had been approached in Leeds to be a model, right? So she was a student, an art student. She'd been approached by Vidal Sassoon to be one of their faces of Vidal Sassoon. And we went, and she told me she'd never been to opera or never been to ballet. I think it's ballet or opera. I cannot remember which one, and I apologize for not remembering. So I was from London. I grew up in London. So I promised to take her, bought tickets, and took her to London, where I was from, for a night where we stayed at my parents. And we went to the opera. But I walked around and showed all the places I'd been in London. And whilst we were there, she was approached by a very, very top model agent who said, if you're not represented, I need to represent you. Have you ever modeled? She said, yeah, for one client, Vidal Sassoon. She said, I want to represent you. So the woman started a conversation with her and took her number and was calling her and chasing her, like an A&R man almost. And she said to Amanda, if you seriously want to make a run of this, you have to live in London. So I was from London living in Leeds. So I just finished my degree. No, I don't know how I finished my degree. And I got a Desmond, as we call it, a 2-2.
It wasn't a degree in the music business.
No, it was a degree in economics. But by the way, that's very important. We'll get to that. But that's very important, because it's called the music business. And the business side, I had a grasp of. And my parents are very entrepreneurial. So I was used to having business in my mind. And at which point I say to myself, right, I'm totally besotted by this woman. She's now going to move to London. I've had label offers for years because my club was so successful. The club I did with Susie and Paul got voted number one club in Europe in this magazine called DJ Magazine, which is highly influential, still is today. The top 100 DJs in the world is something that every Tiesto, Calvin, Martin, they all want to be in the top of. Whereas at this point, they also had this thing called the top club in Europe. We were the top club in Europe for 2 years, and they ran the magazine ran bi-monthly. So imagine, this is incredible. So every label called me up. Do you want to do A&R? Do you want to do marketing? Do you want to come? And I was like, no. Then my wife got this offer to go to London, and I was like, okay, I'll come to London. And I thought to myself, well, if I'm in London with her, what the fuck am I going to do during the day? So I called up. I had this offer from a guy called Andy Thompson and Pete Tong, who we all know, who lives in LA, who's a DJ, very, very successful DJ. And Pete and Andy said to me, come and work at London Records. And I said, yeah, but you're going to give me a junior product manager job, and I'm already earning...
I'm the man.
I'm earning the money that the president earns, right? And they turned around and said, we will give you a junior product manager job, and we'll give you a car and all the perks that go with it, but here's what we're going to do. Because Pete was the world's most famous DJ, this before the EDM thing happened, he's allowed to work till Thursday night, and between Friday and Sunday, he's allowed to do things. And in fact, we actively encourage it because we specialize in dance music here. So by you being on the road and playing the records, you're bringing in your A&R acumen, your marketing acumen. You know what's going down in the club. And we're all like 40-something guys. We don't know what's going on in the club. So I tell you what, you can run your club, you can be a DJ, and you can have a job. And I was like, shit.
That's perfect.
I can, you know, have my cake and eat it. Boom, I'm in, right? Perfect. So I moved to London with my long-term partner, wife, mother of my children. And I go to London. She becomes a successful model. I continue what I'm doing. And until 1996, when I left London to set up Northwest Side Records with Christian, because we both lived in Northwest London, and that's our postcode.
It's Christian Tatterfield,
who ended up becoming the chairman of Warner's, and now runs a new company called Good Soldier Records and Good Soldier Publishing. Very, very brilliant executive. me and him set a label up, and by 97, 98, I was thinking, this DJ, they're going to laugh, this DJ thing's peaked, all right? And I'm going to get out before the millennium, and cut to America explodes, and obviously I've now retired from DJing. And at that point, I thought, once we did the label, once we'd signed Jay, once we signed a band called Another Level, it's not fair to Christian to be his partner and me just disappearing like for 3 days a week around the world and coming back tired and not really engaged till Wednesday. Mm-hmm. And I felt that if I was going to commit to one thing and if I was going to become a truly successful record executive, to aspire to be like my peers, not my peers, that's the wrong thing, they're not my peers, to aspire to be like my heroes, the Armitts, the Clive Davises, now I'd put Jimmy in that category, the Berry Gordys, they didn't have a second job on the side.
No, said it was that, all in.
Later on, Jimmy spun off into other businesses, but he when he left being a producer and an engineer, he was full-time into thing. And I decided in 97 that I was gonna give up the clubs, give up DJing, and step out. Ironically, my wife, who is a successful model, earning hundreds of thousands of dollars as a model, decides in the same 2 week period to give up modeling and become an academic. She's now a doctor of history and lectures, right? And so at one point, our household income collapses, but we both agreed that for the long-term future of our passions, that I would become a full-time record exec and take less money. So to go down in our income thing, to button down, not have holidays, not go out, not buy fancy clothes, because we had this dream. I had this dream now that I was going to try with all my might to become 1% of a Berry Gordy, 1% of a Clive Davis. And that was the dream. And she wanted to be, she said, I no longer want to be judged on my looks. I want to, I'm a bright woman. And the way I'm going to empower myself is I'm going to go back to university.
Perfect. Let me decapsulize all that, folks. Start a club, meet girls, do drugs, find the best girl, marry her, move to London, and then take a job. Now,
by the way, in the middle of that, stop taking drugs.
And stop taking drugs, of course. So I just want to make sure
drugs,
I had
let
that.
Let me just say this clearly. Yeah. Drugs, long term,
not good.
Do not help your career, and in fact, is a bad thing for you to do.
They make you feel smarter, but they're really not.
Didn't make me feel smart.
Okay, let's talk about, you have been one of the top A&R guys. We got a question. Tell Uni to hang. What's this question? You know what it is here, Kira? Okay, ask him what his question.
It's a pre-planned question though, for you.
Okay. All right, before we go there, Kip, we got one of our members on the line there. Real quick, let's take that question from Uni Saul first, okay? Because Nick and I could go on forever. What time you got to be out of here, Nick?
I've got a lunch at 12:30. I've got to be at.
Okay, perfect. We're rolling then.
I shouldn't say where, because I might have someone come and give me a slap when I get
there.
We're
doing good. We got Uni Saul, who's from New York, I believe, on the phone. He's one of our Renman regulars. So, Uni, you're on with Nick Raphael, president of Capitol Records.
Hey, Steve, first I wanted to say thank you for making this happen. And Nick, I wanted to say thank you for making yourself accessible. I recently got a chance to check out an interview that you did a couple of years ago on London Real, and you had mentioned you when dealing with an artist, you wanted them to be the first person that you came to see or the last person you came to see after you after they exhausted everything. So you're the first person I'm coming to see. I went to see how
nice
can I show
you
at
Uni.
Yeah. I just wanted to keep it brief.
Okay. Go ahead.
No, that was it. I just went, how can I join your club?
So you can email me. My email is nick.raphael@umusic, like every U-Music executive. We all have the same email. By the way, just to put that in perspective, I'm not the email for every U-Music executive. We all have our own names and our own U-Music accounts. And you feel welcome to email me, say you spoke to me on the Renman show, and then someone in my office will listen properly. If they love it, they'll say to me, we need to listen to this together. If they don't love it, I have to respect the fact that I hire them to be my net, because otherwise I would be listening to 250 unsolicited pieces of music a week, and none of my artists would get any of my time or any of my love. But please send me the email. Because I've spoken to you, I'll listen myself, and there's a promise. If everybody calls up and asks me to listen,
I will. He's the first. Okay, he gets it. He gets, as he
exactly.
Said,
first come, by the way, I'm down with that. First come, first serve.
Listened by me. The rest of them can be listened by Matt in my office or Charlie in my office.
Yeah, it's the first guy over the mountain that really has balls. The rest are just fucking sheep, folks. Exactly. Okay.
So happily
Uni, you get the reward for being the lone wolf, not the sheep. Uni, thanks for calling here, bud.
Yeah. Thank you, you guys.
Okay. Any great questions in the chat room while we're rolling here, Kira?
Don't
give me some pity F, man. Give me something real here.
I'll pity F you. This guy wants to know, what's the best way to approach promoters?
Promoters? We're going to talk about that one later. The best way to promote, we're going to talk about that in a different segment, okay? We're talking with a record label guy today, all right, folks? So let's keep it on point. Let's talk about A&R for a second. It's one of the mystery positions, I think. Yep. If you want to work at a record label, kids want to be an artist, they want to be a manager, or they want to be an A&R guy, and of course they would accept being the president of a label, and oftentimes you find that the presidents of labels have some experience as A&R, right? This music business starts with great songs and great performers. You know, if you've obviously demonstrated some talent for being, to be able to identify talent, commercial talent, before the story has been told, which is the key part. You know, this is not like deciding, oh, I would have signed Nirvana. No, when it was there the first time, it would be the one. My first question to you, as it comes up all the time, is what, in short, what is a great song for a guy who's made a living as an A&R guy? If I ask him, Nick, what's a great song? All these kids think they wrote a great song. What's a great song in your eyes?
I can't describe a great song. All I can do is feel a great song.
Okay.
So when Joe and I have this rule, and Joe Charrington and I have worked together 20 years, and we have this rule that we say, if the pair of us don't love it, or the one can't convince the other of how good a song is, then it isn't good enough. Mm. And, you know, she has a female perspective. I have a male perspective. She loves melody. I love words. Right, which is really weird because normally the woman loves words, and I don't mean that. We have that yin and yang. And if we have to debate it, it isn't good enough.
Yeah.
If we say to each other, oh my God, I remember hearing Stay With Me, and Sam has three managers, right? Because they have other acts, so they split their time between their other artists. They're three brilliant guys, Elvin, Jack and Sam. There's Jimmy, who's the co-writer for a lot of the stuff, who's Sam's go-to. There's Sam, and there's Joe and I, and there's Stephen who worked with Jimmy to help make the record. But outside of Stephen, who wasn't in the song process, was only in the production process, we would get a song in, and normally say, for instance, a lot of them would obviously done with Jimmy and Sam, it'd come in. There was rarely a debate when a song came in that was a winner. And when one guy was fighting for a song and others weren't fighting for a song, it was almost like we don't need to have a conversation. Yeah. You know, if the artist felt strongly and wants it on the album, that's their prerogative. But if it were a single, you knew. You know, Stay With Me came in, we didn't all sit there and say, sure about that, maybe. Or I'm Not The Only One came in. I mean, I remember my text to them, that we changed the arrangement slightly because they went for a crazy arrangement. And even Jimmy said on his thing, we've gone for this crazy arrangement, but, and I sent them back and says, could you please put in a proper arrangement and then I'll listen again. And then the minute I heard the proper arrangement, I said, that's a future classic. But you know, before I'd sent my text, Sam Evett, who manages him, had already sent a note. Elvin had already sent a note. Joe had already sent a note. Jack concurred with Sam Evett's note. There was no sheep. It was like, you all just went, fuck me, right?
Well, now you bring up something interesting in there, which is that one of the questions I was gonna ask you is, I think when people are trying to figure out the role of an A&R company or an A&R person, everybody gets this preset of, oh, the big bad label is telling Sam Smith or telling, you know, five seconds.
Trust me, I tell Sam Smith anything.
It's actually more subtle than that. It's what you just talked a little bit about. It's providing perspective. Talk a little bit about your role in the A&R process of trying to get the best material, the best performance out of a great artist.
I look at my role, or our role, Joe and my role, and I even think there's some true of them on the marketing guys, all of them. Your role in this process, I don't mean to be disrespectful to Universal, but I work for the artist. Because if the artist succeeds and does a huge amount of sales, right, Universal benefit. So my focus is on their needs. some artists come in and they have great songs and they've done great things already, and your job is just to give them confidence and facilitate them. Other artists have come in over the years we've worked with, and they have a great voice, and they have a good idea who they are, and they're ambitious, but they have no clue how to make that record that they have articulated to us, but they know what it should sound like. So we say, this person can help you. They meet one person, and sometimes the person you think can help them, there's no chemistry and they hate each other. So that relationship can't
work. So part of it's matchmaking a little bit.
Totally matchmaking. I feel like I'm the coach in a team, and when a player is playing well, I just say, everything you're doing is right, just keep doing it. And when they're playing badly, I say, you know what? You just got to get through this patch, but just stick to your principles. You're not in a bad place. Or I say, you keep throwing everything to the right. Now throw something to the left, right? Or throw it down the middle. Just try. Don't do any. Just basically, you're focusing on this, but actually, if you went there, it might not be the right thing, but what it'll do is open your perspective again. Because artists and creative people sometimes get themselves stuck in a rut. And your job is not, you can't solve it. I'm not a musician. I can't come in and go, oh, you should go to B flat. It's like, you're a dick. I can't say that. But what I can say is, you know what? And sometimes your job is also to give perspective. After 23 years, and you can't learn this, and Joe is brilliant at this, sometimes you say to an artist, you know, I've been here before with this artist, and you love this artist, and they went on to become humongous, right?
Yeah.
So we've all been there, and you have to respect the human beings, respect where they are, and there is never two artists, or never two points in an artist's career, and also your relationship changes, where you behave in a different way. You know,
I think that's such an important point, and we talk about it a lot in the context of this course, that when people are looking for a checklist, right, and they want it to make sense, right? If you're looking for something to make sense, I would say the music business is not a great place to start, because the point you made is so important, is that it's different for everybody. What works for you might not work for me. Yeah. What makes you feel great might not work for me. And that's true across the board. There is no tried and true path. And so understanding that for people out there, whether you're an artist or a professional, is absolutely key to this whole thing. Let me ask you this. So many of the folks out here are looking to get signed to a label. And when a label signs an artist, they're making a huge commitment of time and money and resources. And so deciding which artist to sign is everything. Having that ability to spot commercial potentials, an A&R guy, is how you keep your job, right? So my question is this. When you are actually now signing an artist, what is it that you are looking for, and what are some of the factors that you play in this mix when you're signing an artist and about to make that commitment? It's
the things that Joe and I will look for, first and foremost.
By the way, can I interrupt you? I'm going to show you a picture of Joe. You keep referring to Joe. We're going to talk about her a little bit more as one of your partners. Joe is Nick's
She's my
A&R partner.
She's EVP of A&R. She really is A&R person. And as time has gone on, she leads the A&R. And any credit or awards that we've received is her award.
I am now
the sort of, you know, I'm the guy in the back room who's saying to her, yeah, that's a good idea. Just keep doing it. Keep doing that,
Joe.
She drives it. She's brilliant. She's the best, in my opinion, statistically, she's the best.
Well, let's talk about her a little bit later, because she's great. And by the way, very pretty, okay?
Okay.
So back to what is it, what are the factors that...
So there's three factors. I'm going to apologize for jumping over you.
You and I could just talk forever, dude. I have to play jockey here a little bit. No offense.
Not at all. So number one factor, likability. You can be the most talented, ambitious fucker on the universe. If you are unlikable, the public are going to hate you. If you are a dick and a douche, you are a dick and a douche.
Let's not name any names. Axl Rose?
You can name whoever you like.
He never comes out anyway. Fine. Jesus, he'll never hear about this guy. Sorry.
So, number one. Number two, ambition. If you are fucking lazy and you are not willing to sacrifice, then you will fail. Fact. Number three, and third in the importance, is talent. Because we can name some of the greatest artists of all time, and there are better singers, better guitar players, better songwriters, and better musicians than them. But the truth is, they had ambition, likability, and enough talent, and enough songwriting ability, or they were good at pairing up with other songwriters and musicians that made the difference. And the bottom line is, you know, Frank Sinatra didn't write a song.
Single song.
But he's still my favorite fucking artist,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
Elvis Presley wasn't a songwriter, right? But has charisma and likability and ambition all day long. Mm. These people, right, superstars, are not superstars by accident.
Yeah.
They fucking work hard. I am seeing what 5 Seconds of Summer, Sam, Jay-Z, Ollie Murs, Paloma Faith, any actor you can name that we've worked with, right, to get to where they get to, the amount of work they put in is unbelievable. And, if they earn 10 times in a 1 year what someone earned in a lifetime, I promise you they put 10 they times more work in than most people put in a lifetime.
It's so important to hear you say that again. I know, this is why I love talking to you, Nick, because and for the folks out there watching, you think it's just about talent, but when you do this every day, and you've been doing it for 23 years, fuck, I'm not even going to tell you how many years I've been doing it, that attitude, that ambition is so key, because this business will test your commitment every single day in ways that you couldn't possibly imagine. And so it's great to hear you say that. And for all you folks out there, that was pretty simple. Likeability, ambition, and then talent, because without those first two, the talent may not matter. Let me ask you something else that I get asked all the time. Today, we can get indicators that we couldn't get 20 years ago, certainly when I was starting in the business, probably even when you were starting, right? So things like social media, SoundCloud, Facebook, all these little touch points that we now have as an industry, how important are those in the mix for you? Or are they important at all?
I can't say they're not, because that would be a stupid thing to say. I'm not a fan of research. But it would be stupid of me to hear something that someone plays, like one of our scouts, or Joe likes it because she's had a tip on it, and says to me, check this out. And I say, where are they at, right? Where are they at in what they're doing?
So that career development part of the equation is important.
What have they done for themselves already? What have they done for themselves? Also, it's a good indication of ambition. Okay. Number two is, you know, Sam Smith's digital, even though he'd been on Latch in the UK, was very low. And his managers were very adamant we didn't do what record companies do, which is spend marketing money to drive people to like and to their Twitter and their Instagram. They were like, we want to see a real gauge of where he's at. So they were very adamant on it. In complete contrast, where we spent zero money again, 5 Seconds of Summer, because of Richard and Harry's involvement in One Direction and One Direction as their mentors, took them on tour, old fashioned style, they took them on tour. And because of that, took them on tour, the digital engagement was high. But it was also an indication of, did the One Direction fans like their new band, their friends, right?
Yeah.
And it was very clear very quickly. So by the time we signed them, they had 250,000 followers. Today, that number is like multi-million, off the chain. And that's obviously due to their hard work, their likability, some good songs, and all the things we talked about. But the truth is, if I was basing it around which other record companies, and I don't wish to name names, because I think majority of record companies, particularly American record companies, with their research and looking at digital numbers and digital spikes, I would never assign Sam Smith, or Joe would never assign Sam Smith. I wouldn't have allowed it. I said, Joe, no, stats aren't good enough. Let's wait till the stats are bigger.
Yeah.
But we met him and we fell in love.
Yeah.
But with 5 Seconds of Summer, we met them and fell in love, and then we looked at the digital engagement and went, well, there's another tick in the box.
Yeah.
But the truth of the matter is, if they were douches and they had 250,000 followers,
I would have said,
fuck that. By the way, there's a load of bands that come off YouTube, or not bands, artists, who've had huge YouTube engagement signed for huge amounts of money that you've never heard of.
Yeah. You mentioned something else in there, and we're going to talk of them about a little bit more about Richard and when we talk about partners. How important is having an engaged, smart, and perhaps experienced manager part of that signing checklist mentality?
I'll say this out loud. I'll look at the camera and I'll say this. If your manager is a douche, even if you are likable, I am not in. The number one reason is, we are going to spend a minimum of 18 months getting you to market. And in that 18 months, I'm going to speak to you, your manager, and my staff, and the people I hire around you are going to speak to your manager. If your manager is a prick, I am going to get disengaged very quickly. Richard, you name, is highly experienced, and Harry, they're brilliant, and the Modest Crew, one of the best management companies in the world.
And
there
he can be
no
a tough character at times.
He's the toughest, but his intentions are good. He's actually likable, right? He's honest, right? Brutally. And he's professional.
Yeah.
But then on Sam's management, they were relative newbies. Mm-hmm. But these guys had ambition, likability, passion.
Learn fast.
And they soaked everything in. Thanks. And they never got stuck. And their argument is intelligent people are flexible. And I think Warren Buffett, Joe always quotes Warren Buffett or Charlie Munger, one of those two, that says, always be prepared to break your own rules. Now, certain things we did on Sam was against my every instinct as a record executive. Mm. But those very bright managers, right, would say, we don't like when record companies do this. Mm. We think that it gives a negative view, like spending money on social media to drive engagement.
Yeah.
They're saying the music should drive engagement and you should drive people to the music, not to the individuals. So we said, okay, we'll follow your lead. Rich and Harry, having come off the One Direction experience, having come off all the huge success they've had, and we've had 100% success rate with them, I wanted to work with these guys again. Mm. They expressed a desire to work with Joe and I again. Mm. So yes, he's some of my toughest weeks. Yeah. Right, Richard, you know him very well.
I do.
He was brilliant on this on this panel. But let me just say this. I would travel to the end of the earth, right, to work with him and Harry and Modest again.
Yeah.
Because every time's great. I would do the same for Method James guys and Sam Smith guys and Elvin and those crew. They're brilliant. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is, just an example of how much we like our managers and how we are not them and us. There is no enemy. Mm-hmm. We all work
together, folks.
Right? We all work for the artist. When we sign an act, we invite the manager to sit in our office free of charge, right? They run their other businesses from then there. Why do we do that? Because when we're making decisions or having a discussion, we stop the them and us scenario, and they can say to us, we don't want to do that, right? And we can accept that, but we're in the same open plan office, and we say, can you approve this sleeve? Can you approve this edit? Yeah. Can you speak to Sam about this?
Yeah.
The Modest guys have a girl called Gabby who sits in our office, does digital. There's there's two Katies who work for them, Kate and Katie. And they sit in our office doing their stuff. And Richard and Harry, if they have meetings on the meetings on the high street, which is like Music Mile in the UK, and they need to borrow a meeting room or they need to have a meeting, they call us up and say, can we use it? Because in my view is we, as a label, are there for the artist's benefit. Mm. And the manager is taking 20% of what the artist makes, right?
He's getting 20%,
whatever the percentage is, I'm guessing based on I'm not a manager. But the truth of the matter is, if the artist succeeds, right?
Everybody
and they sell tickets and their publishing's worth more and this worth more, then we are benefiting. Mm. So we should do everything we can, but there is no them and us. That's a bullshit, old-fashioned view.
I think that's good stuff. We got a call from the UK, back in the hometown, Stephen O'Reilly, another longtime person who I met through the show here. Mr. O'Reilly, you are on with Nick Raphael.
Hello, sir. Thanks for having me on the show.
No problem. Nice to have you back again. How's the weather there in Blighty, Stephen?
It's remarkably okay. It's not raining today, so I'm sure Nick knows the weather here better than anyone else.
That was so Irish. It's remarkably okay.
Yes.
Anyway, sorry for fist taking there. We got a question for Nick here?
Yeah. I'm a massive fan of Nick, and I've followed his work for years. And I was wondering, I manage some bands myself, and I was wondering, you know, what his thoughts were on some of the major labels having, like, label services deals, and if those label services deals that are part of what the record labels offer, so, like, Universal have Spin Up now, and Sony have their own, and all the... Are these, like, an interesting way or a good way for to get on the radar of the label as an artist or a manager to get your act, like, elevated somewhat if you can't go the A&R route?
I honestly don't have a view. I live in my own cocoon. We run our label in a complete opposite way to every other major record label. But anything that allows a band to have a greater platform must be good for the band, especially if they can't get the correct A&R interest that they want. And if through that, through those label services, it gets them to a level where they sell 30, 50, 60, 100,000 albums and puts them in a position where every label wants to engage with them, that must be a good thing. My personal understanding of what label services are is zero.
I'm only taking from the information you just gave me during the this phone conversation. But the truth of the matter is, I don't know enough about it because, you know, I wake up every day worrying about the four acts, five acts assigned to my label and focusing on the method by which we operate. So when someone says to me, other labels sign 40 acts to get one successful one or 25 acts to get one successful one, I say, that's great for them. That's not my business. That's not the business I run. I don't have a catalog. I don't have international repertoire. We only have the acts that we sign. So I think based on what you said, you are very logical. Yes, it must be good for the artist. And, you know, these things don't exist if they don't have a purpose and they don't have a benefit for the people because other people wouldn't use it. But I can't give you an informed answer because it's not an area I operate within.
Stephen?
Yeah, no worries. Like, I just wanted to highlight there was Spin Up, which is part of Island Records now, and they said that it's a great way to get on the radar for Island. You know, it's part of Universal. And I was just
follow up on that.
Yeah, maybe it's not your remit. Cool.
All right, Stephen, thanks so much for calling in, and it's always a pleasure talking to you, old bean.
Likewise, I love the show, and thank you. I learned so much.
Good. Well, I appreciate it. You know, Stephen and I had a beer back. Where was it? I went to the Medium conference once, and there was Stephen, and he was gracious enough to buy me a beer. He brings up an interesting point there, Nick, which is, you know, assuming the band's got some talent, they've got managers and all of that kind of stuff, what is the best way to connect with an A&R person? Is it, we talked a little bit about this the other night, this whole trusted sources and how you get the attention of a big time executive. You've been at this conference all week and 300 people come up and hand you a CD. That's probably not the best way.
It's the worst way.
Briefly give us an idea of how should somebody go about connecting or attempting to connect with a label?
It's osmosis. There's no one way of doing it. You know, if you know us, you've worked with us, you've been successful with us, I'll never refuse a meeting with you. Mm. If I've never heard of you, and you email me pretending like you know me, right? You're a douche and you're an idiot. And you know, and sometimes I get someone calling, telling my assistant, no, I know him, I know Nick. And then says randomly, I bumped into you at something and you're literally like, that's not based on knowing me, right? So the truth is, you know, the way artists have come to us over the years.
What about Sam Smith in 5 seconds?
Sam Smith is a really easy story. We worked with a guy 20 years ago, Joe and I, at London Records. He went off to set his own independent label up and he previously managed Jimmy Napes. And he was, I believe, Jimmy Napes left him as a management client, but they remained friends. And Jimmy told him about this artist who'd come through his door, Sam Smith, and was incredible. But he'd gone to another management company where the same management company that Jimmy was at. And he said, they've written this song, Latch, with this band, Disclosure. Joe said, great. And he sent a link to Latch. Jo listened to it. She thought she loved Latch. And she told me to listen to it and said we should get the management in. We got the management in and the rest is history.
So they came through the back door and then you connected to the manager.
So there was a trusted source, someone we knew personally.
For 20 years.
For 20 years. And we paid him introducer's fee. We paid him a bonus on it. Mm-hmm. You know, we're happy to do that to people that we know. So we did that. That's not a problem.
5 seconds of summer.
5 seconds of summer. Well, Richard, we'd had first Richard, I believe, and Richard can correct me. His first successful management client was Lamar when he stopped being, you know, I'd worked with Richard at BMG when he was my boss, and God, that was hard.
Richard, if you're watching, it's true though, folks.
Exactly.
Oh, he's tough.
So, when I left him, which was slightly acrimonious in leaving, the day I arrived there, he sent me the loveliest note ever and a great magnum of champagne and said, I only fought for you because I respect you. And I was like, and I was honored because he's a legend, in my opinion. And then when he went into management, and most people presume when a big time exec goes into management, they're going to fall flat on their face. But don't underestimate Richard. And him and Harry teamed up.
Harry was another former executive.
He used to work for Richard. He was head of RCA Records in the UK. Very talented guy as well, the pair of them. And they had an act called Lamar, who was actually signed to Universal. And they managed to get Lamar off Universal and to us. And we made a record with Lamar, Joe and I. And it was hugely successful. The guy had three multi-platinum records. And then we worked with him again on a band called JLS.
which Richard by then was working with Simon Cowell doing the X Factor acts. We picked up JLS. Their first album sold 1.65 million copies. And they, you know, again, lost the show, but won in the charts. And then the third act was Ollie Murs, who is an incredible artist, still doing incredibly well today. And I'm honored that we got to work with him. He's a great guy. So we'd had you know, 100% record, 3 for 3. And Richard came to us and said, listen, I've got this act. Sony passed, because obviously that was his natural partner, because most of his business was there.
Yep.
He said, and there's only other people I want to go with is you guys. And I said, we want to work with you. We want to work with you as well. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, come and see the band. So we went to Ireland. We saw the band play a show, Joe and I. And 30 seconds into the first song, I looked at Richard and I said, we're in.
He said, 30 seconds into 5 seconds, you said, we're in.
Yeah.
I love it. We got another question here from the UK, right?
Oh, God.
A gentleman by the name of Amos.
Do I owe them money?
No, I don't think so.
Please check that before we take the call.
Although, Nick, he is touring in America with his band, this crazy little fuck, man. So he probably will need a loan. You're on the phone. You got him there. Eamon Saleh from, I forget where in London or England. Eamon, where are you in America today?
Richmond, Virginia.
Richmond, Virginia, where I guarantee it's hot and muggy, huh?
It's not muggy, actually. The weather's great. Yeah, it's really good.
It's early. Good thing you don't touring in June. Anyway, this is another kid who I met through the web show. Actually, he's one of our first students for our Renman U course, which we'll talk about here in a second. Sharp guy, always talking about how to connect with people. I put him on to Kevin Lyman. He connected with him, and now you're talking to the president of Capitol Records. Take it away, Eamon.
Hey, Nick. How you doing?
Not bad. How are you?
I'm making you feel at home here with all this local. Okay.
Oh, Ren, you have no idea. It's crazy. I'm watching the show, and I've just heard him use the term Desmond, which I have not even heard back home for years. So,
okay, your question, great. Now that you guys have done your English stroke here, get to the question, okay?
Oh, yeah, sure, okay. I should say really quickly is that economics degree also scared me into the music business, so we have that in common.
Cool.
But my question is, when you're breaking artists, discovering and breaking artists, how important do you feel it is for them to have an existing fan base? So, for example, on two levels, is it a prerequisite before you sign an artist? Or do you go, oh, it doesn't matter, we can make it work? Or do you go, oh, they have to have an existing fan base? And if so, at that level, have you had experience with don't have a fan base and it flopping because of it, or not being a problem, or existing artists, you launch them and it's like they have an existing fan base, it just takes off?
Existing fan base is not a prerequisite for signing, is not a prerequisite for launching. But fuck me, it's a brilliant to know that there's 20,000 people, 30,000 people out there that already like your band, that already engaged in your band, already seeing them on the road, they can already fill venues. I'll give you an example. We signed an act called Scouting for Girls in 2008. Their first album sold 1.4 million copies. And the boys, when we first signed them, had 2,000 people signed up to their Wolf Cub, which was like like an old-fashioned fan club. And everywhere they played, they could sell to 200 people, right? Now, 200 people is a small, you know, what we would call the toilet tour, the back of pubs, the worst venues in the world, but they could fill them. And the promoters were like, shit, this band we don't even know about, Nick, that you've signed, but they can sell out 12 shows in the UK. Mm-hmm. And it was like, wow, they can sell 12 shows in the UK. So when we took the radio people to go and see them, and they already could see the audience, and of course also see the audience was the right demographic for them, It gave us a platform. It gave us trampoline to bounce up to the next level. Is it necessary? No. Have we signed acts that have no fan base? Yes. Do I want them to have a fan base? Of course, because if you've got a fan base, but your problem is you can't get the material right, we'll help you get the material right. But if you have the material right and you don't have a fan base, maybe there's something like you're not likable or there's a problem. So the fact you have a fan base suggests to me that someone likes you somewhere down the line. Mm. So it's not a prerequisite, but it's a Brucey bonus if you have it.
There you have it, Eamon, from the top. That's the view from the top. How are you having fun out there in America?
Sorry?
Are you having fun out there on tour?
Yeah, it's really good. The response has been excellent, and it's really just coming to fruition, especially self-booking. It means, you know, like all our hard work's paying off. So that's, yeah.
Talk about fuck the gatekeepers. The guy comes over here, no agent, no nothing, and they're booking a tour on their own using all the tools. Great. Eamon, you're my fucking poster boy of fuck the gatekeepers. Keep it up, my friend, and enjoy your little ride here in America. And don't fuck with the cops in Virginia, all right? Just watch the news.
Good luck, by the way.
Thank you so much, Ren, and thanks, Nick. Cheers.
No problem. Okay, Cody, I wanted to show me that graphic. I put together this course, Nick. My gosh, you should write a book. Well, I can't write a book. It fucking takes me forever just to be short and sweet. And you and I writing a book would be a fucking opus of 1,000 pages just for the introduction.
We need 12 volumes.
Oh, yeah. We need at least 12. So I started this little web course called Insider's Guide to Today's Music Business, what I hope is a realistic look. Show them some of the lessons we got in there, Code. We did lessons on managers, and what else do we got over there? Picking your partners. And this is the one I wanted to talk about today. And these are all things that I've learned over the years that go well beyond who's going to take the song to radio, who does the cover, and all that stuff. And one of those lessons is this idea of picking the right partners, because picking the right partners, whether you're in the music business or you're looking to do something in any walk of life, picking the right partners is crucial. If you get it right, great things have happened. Now, in my humble opinion, you've shown a deft touch for picking the right partners over the years, and safe to say it's had a huge impact for you. There are three partners in particular. We've touched on some of them already, but I want to talk about a little bit more about them that you've worked with over the years that have had paid a potentially even more crucial role. I mean, one of them was that lovely partner of yours, the lovely Joe Charing. Is that Charrington or Charrington?
Charrington.
Charrington. Okay, tell us a little bit about Joe and how you guys hooked up, because whenever I see you reference, it sounds like your lover or your wife when they do, your longtime partner, and I'm thinking, interesting.
We make a joke, because obviously we both got our own wives and husbands.
Okay.
And we make a joke that she's my work wife. You know, okay. We've said that many, many times. Joe's like my big sister. Technically, she's my big sister. She's 11 months older. I say that embarrassing her because now the world knows.
Oh, God.
I'll get killed for that
Nick's
one.
Nick's 36.
Okay. So the truth is, when I joined London Records in 1994, Christian had the office next door to me, Christian Tatsfield, who later became a partner of mine, business partner of mine. And Joe was the marketing assistant to both of us. Mm. And she basically covered up for the fact I had no knowledge of what label copy was or how to do artwork or that thing. I had all big picture ideas. She got shit done. And she never asked for anything for the basically covering my ass. She covered for me in meetings when I was in meetings. I said, no, we got that done. She booked ads I didn't know were meant to be booked. Mm. She basically did my job for me while I took all the plaudits. Nothing has changed in 20 years except... In 2001, when Rob Stringer, who runs Columbia in America, was the chairman of Sony UK, he hired me to replace him as the managing director of Epic Records, which is where I met you. And my A&R department, in my opinion, was terrible. Mm. And, you know, Rob was really the A&R person for the company, and the other guys were just basically filling in the gaps. And so the A&R department was let go, very politely. And 6 months in, Rob said, who are you going to hire? And I said, Joe Charrington. He said, she's a fucking manager, because she managed an act at the time that had been successful.
I can just hear him say, she's a fucking
exactly.
manager.
You know, never trust a manager. And even though Richard hired loads of managers, as we discussed the other night, and they were all hugely successful. Look at Steve Barnett, yourself.
Yeah. You know,
look
I
at
was the weak link
David
in that
Massey.
Course.
You know, they were all managers, weren't they? And Jed Doherty. Mm-hmm. And so I hired Joe on the premise that 51% of the world's music is bought by women. Mm-hmm. But how many women are doing A&R, right? So she must have an insight to how the other half think.
And not shy about expressing it here. This is a comment she made when she was talking to you about Sam Smith, wasn't it? An artist like Sam comes on every 20, don't fuck this up. Is that what Joe told you?
Oh, fuck me. Joe talks to me. I have a wife who tells me what to do. I have a mother who tells me what to do. I have a 12-year-old daughter who tells me what to do.
Geez.
And then I get to work, and Joe basically says, what the fuck are you wearing? She says to me, that's the worst decision you've ever made. She said to me, why don't you call him up and tell him what you think of him? And then I do it, and the person goes crazy. And then she said, why did you do that? I'm like, you told me to do that.
How does any of this happen? My wife's over here watching in the wings, and I'm just sitting there smiling.
They say behind every successful man is a woman. Behind me is five of them, yeah? So the truth is that, and then since 2001,
Rob was really, really negative on the idea of her as an A&R person. He didn't think she had the chops. He didn't think she had the experience. He wanted someone who had previously done A&R. But I said, but every fucker does A&R has like a 1 in 25 ratio. And my ratio is better than that. And if I hire this lady who's got loads of experience in the music business, maybe I can school her in the way I think. She comes from the same place I did, which is London Records, so she understands the logic, which is where I stole a lot of my ideas from. And I can, you know, the A&R bit she can learn. He's like, you don't learn A&R. And I said, you do. And it's about being around it and thing. Anyway, by 2008, she signed Paloma Faith. She drove that signing. I ballsed up, there's a very famous story, I ballsed up the showcase with the artist. I end up in a slagging match. I think she called me a cunt. And I told her she's an Amy Winehouse wannabe. The rest is history. I'm repeating the story she's already repeated. She's now on her third album, and it's going to be the biggest album of career. She's never sold less than 750 hard albums,
in
no
the
TAs,
UK.
In the UK and around the world. She's an incredible artist. She just won the Brit for Best Female on her third album. That was a special, special lady. And Joe made that signing, not me. For the first time, it was Joe's. Whereas it used to be my signing, and she made the records, or she helped do it. She stopped helping.
Yeah.
And I started helping her. And that transition happened. Very funny, and I'm not going to say anything to embarrass Rob because he's a good friend and an incredible executive. Yep. But I remember him going to a conference after all this, a global Sony conference, and saying, you know, Simon has Sonny Takkar, who's brilliant. He's number two. He's an incredible, incredible executive. And I then had Joe Charrington. And he said, we all need a Sonny Takkar or a Joe Charrington. You've got to look at your organization and say, who is your Sonny Takkar
and
Joe Charrington?
And he left out the part, as people do in the music business.
The rewrite.
And I love Rob String if he's watching. God bless you. If you want to come on the show and defend yourself. But history has been rewritten countless times in the music business that always ends with, did I tell you I'm a fucking genius?
Let me tell you, I'm not
did
a genius.
Did I mention that I'm a genius? Yeah. Fuck yeah.
I'm not a genius. I'm lucky. I work with incredible people. You've named Joe. In my opinion, like I said, she is now the best A&R person in the world.
And a fine role model for women out there that are trying to do something who think that, you know, because somehow you're a woman that disqualifies is bullshit, folks.
Well, let me just say about women. It's very interesting. I'm a huge admirer and a good friend of Jodie Gershon.
She's been on the show.
I absolutely love and respect Michelle Capital. She is incredible. She's an incredible lawyer. She's now turning into a world-class music executive. And I went for dinner with her last night. Top girl, right? Sarah Stennett, I was with yesterday. A world-class manager. She is different gravy.
You got to help me get Sarah on this show. I like her.
Let me just say about these people, right? I think in the misogynist world of music, they have to work twice as hard, and they're twice as good as the male counterparts. They deserve more credit than any of the guys who are in some boys' club where we all play golf. I don't play golf, guys, right? Or they're drinking buddies, whatever. And these girls, when they achieve what they achieve, trust me, if you think at home you're crying about your band not getting signed or not getting a meeting, trust me, what these women have to go through, you know, Alison Donald at Columbia in London, who just did
Brenda
George Ezra record.
Big time promotion.
She's an incredible lady. She's world class. You know, and I'm missing loads of Julia Atlantic here, who I don't know at all, but Christian speaks very highly of her. There's a lot of very, 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 very talented women.
Yeah.
And I think this business is for too long. We're selling the majority of our product to women, and we're running around as a boys' club telling women what they like. Can I tell a woman what to wear?
Because she's telling us what to wear.
Exactly.
Okay,
That's a joke telling me what to wear. She's failing badly.
Yeah. Let's talk about, enough about Joe, because she'll be calling you up asking for a raise here
shortly.
She'll
be on the phone in a minute, say I owe her money again.
Let's talk about the other guy that probably gets a lot of those calls. We talked enough about Richard. God bless you. But I'm telling you, if you folks haven't watched the interview with Richard Griffiths, it's really must-watch stuff here on any number of levels, publishing, managers, all kinds of things, and one of my heroes as well. And one of my golfing buddies as well. That was our cement. Let's talk about this other gentleman. I don't even know if we have a picture of Whitey here. We call him affectionately Whitey when I was working at Epic. His name is Steve Barnett. He's the president of Capitol Records. Another, shall we say, ex-manager in Live Wire. Talk about your relationship with Steve Barnett, because that's been going on for years, and it ultimately has culminated now with you being the president of Capitol UK.
I met Steve Barnett similar time I met you. He was the head of international for Epic Records in 2001.
Causing quite a stir over there.
Fucking hell. I mean, I thought Richard gave me a hard time, then I met Steve Barnett. Steve is technically, and I don't think it's rude to say, he's 20 years older than me, and I do not know what he eats for breakfast or what pills he takes in the morning from the vitamin guys, but I need to know what they are. He's the most energetic, the most incredible, driven, focused executive that I've ever worked
with.
Competitive. He has completely changed my life, Joe's life, the lives of our artists. He made some of the most ridiculous proclamations, and then they came true. He's the opposite of most American executives who promise you the world and deliver you nothing. Mm-hmm. He promised us the world and delivered us more than the world. Mm-hmm. Me and him have butt heads during the process of Sam Smith, and then I have to concede to whatever he wants, and then he's been right, so which kills me.
Which makes it even worse.
Which makes it even worse. I thank my lucky stars that David Joseph, who is the chairman of the UK company, because when I was running this label called London Records, which is this romantic idea that Joe and I restarted London Records when we left Sony on a high and went to Universal. And it was going, I mean, we use this term, you know, Pete Tong, the English colloquialism and his Cockney rhyming slang, it was all going Pete Tong. It was all going very badly wrong. And David came to me one day and said, we've just bought EMI and Lucian really wants to focus on Capitol Records, and you know Steve very well, and he's going to launch the American one. What about you do Capitol Records in the UK? And I was like, fuck that shit. What do I want to do that for? You know, I'm doing London Records. That's my baby. Mm-hmm. And he said, this is a priority for us as a corporation. It's a priority for me personally. And you and Joe would be brilliant. And you just put your team in, and you just change the name. Mm-hmm. And the acts that you've already signed, which is 5 Seconds and Sam, will go through Steve. 5 Seconds will go through Steve anyway, because Rich has already declared that in the contract. He's asked that once Steve starts, Steve's going to be the guy.
Yep, cap.
I said, no problem. So I said, you know, I'm not sure this is what I want to do. This is not my dream. And going back to, you've got to break your own rules. Uh-huh. You've got to be flexible. You know, you can't take, you're not going to get everything the way you want it. Mm-hmm. Like when an artist wants to deal with a certain record company and they're not interested, you go to another record company. And David convinced me. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, and from that moment, and the engagement with Steve as my US partner, he's a mentor. He's a brilliantly generous human being. He's a driver. And I would argue he's the best executive in America. I don't care who I offend by saying that.
No, I think you're right.
No other executive in America has made a bigger impact in my career. Now, there's people like David Massey, who have been a great mentor to me and helped me over the years. Rob Stringer gave me my big break. I've been a huge admirer of Lucian, who's obviously my ultimate boss. But the truth is, David partnered me with Steve, and Steve changed the game. And I can tell you a story in Sam Smith that I don't know if it's been repeated, or I don't know if it's been said in things. Steve was not the first on Sam Smith, right? But you don't have to be the first.
You've
got to be the closer, and you have to be right. He went to see him do an Islington Assembly show, which is like a town hall, 750 people. And Steve gets in the venue, and Sam's playing, and mid-playing, he says, he looks at me, he grabs my arm, and he says to me, Nick, one artist changes the course of history of a label. He said, and the new Capitol Records, right, already has Katy Perry, and she is the queen of the label, there's no question. But one artist will change the future and of the next chapter of Capitol Records. It's no disrespect to any of the artists that come before to make the great, incredible catalog, or the current, you know, she's still the queen of the world. She's still the queen of Capitol Records. He says, but this guy, like when Adele came to Columbia, or One Direction went to Columbia, or AC/DC at Columbia, or Beyonce at Columbia, those artists come along and they reinvigorate a label. They tell the world, you're on, you're in. And he said, this is the one. And I said, really? And I looked at Steve and I thought, fuck, this guy blew the worst smoke up my ass. Really? And I love Steve and I know him and I know he's an honest guy.
He's a salesman.
And he went and said the same to Sam. And Sam looked to his left, and there was a guy called Ben Thomas, who was Adele's original guitarist and went to Brit School with Adele. And he said to Ben, is this guy for real? Now, Steve had left the room at this point and I was still there. And Ben Thomas says, he said, everything he said to Adele came true. Right? So there's no reason not to believe this guy. And at this point, Sam technically had the ability to choose any label in America within the Universal system, and a lot of them were trying to have discussions. And I said to all of them, hold off. I have to give it to Steve, but if the artist and manager don't like Steve, then I have to open it up, because contractually I have to do that. And Sam walked out, looked at Jack, Sam and Elvin and said, him, right? And from that day on, Steve drove everything. He drove the shows in the Troubadour, right? He drove us doing Saturday Night Live completely out of sequence with everything else. He went and saw Bob Levitz, who'd been on this show, and played in the fucking record, which is like playing Russian roulette, because Bob could have said, Bob could have turned around and slated it.
Fuck that,
but if you look at what Bell wrote, you went back, you'll show, see how correct Bob was. Mm-hmm. And no one can tell Bob what to write.
Let me tell you something about Bob Levitz. He and I got off to a slow start, although we did make it on the show, and we're doing better now. But what I've learned about Bob is he's a real music fan down deep. You know, he's not just some grisly business, hack about it,
By the way, I'd love Bob to just send out to his thing, the thing that he wrote about Sam when no one knew, right, that Sam was going to work or not work. What he wrote, Richard Griffiths, actually, I found it in my inbox. I know Bob and Richard know each other very well. And I sent it to Richard and I said, fuck, how true is this shit that he wrote, right?
I'm going to send Bob a note when we're done here and ask him to reprint it. We got another question, which before we take it, I want to set it up. That's a great story, by the way. I could go on for days. What time we got to be out of here? It's 11:10. We got another half hour, 20 minutes? Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
One of those lessons, Cody, in that, show him the graphic for our course again. I got to shill here a little bit. Okay, it is America, that insider's guide. One of these big picture lessons that I talk about all the time is about this notion of finding your true north and understanding who you are. And we had, Nick took me out to dinner the other night. What a rocking fucking dinner that was.
Rock. Huh?
God damn, we had the worst table in the house and everybody had to walk by us and everybody was going, who are these two freaking guys over there? Anyway, we were talking about this old notion of authenticity with artists and so forth. Then there was a question that came in. I'm pretty sure it's this gentleman that's actually on the phone now. So what's the gentleman's name there?
Lawrence.
It's Lawrence from where? Well, fuck if I know. Okay, well, anyway, Lawrence, you're on with Nick Raphael, but that was a really, really long question, Lawrence, that I was too fucking tired to write down. So I want you to keep it short because you got two big blowhards here. They're going to talk all day without you. Anyway, take your question, okay? Fire away. You got Nick Raphael on the phone.
All right, great. Thanks, gentlemen. Appreciate your time. My question is this. I started managing my son's rock band back when he was 13, and that's 5 years ago. And over the past 5 years, I've really got indoctrinated into the music world. I've worked with CAA, some major management firms. It's a girl-fronted rock band. They've toured about 150 times with, some of the biggest names in rock, from Chevelle to Stone Sour to Three A's Grace, things of that nature. And I just came to the realization about 6 months ago going to some of these shows that, and some of these top tier rock bands that are in AR, are barely filling these theater rooms. And I started thinking about the revenue and so on and so forth that's coming from AR, and it was just not a good picture. And we've got about six figures into this band right now, and they're doing great, and they get a great response. We finished an EP with the producer of Evanescence and Slipknot. Everything's great. But I just started to realize that this is probably not a great financial decision. So recently we got connected with a pop producer who's, done everybody from Maroon 5 to, Katy Perry. And we're thinking about bending the band more towards a hot AC, more kind of a pop rock alternative. And it's going to be a much more expensive endeavor, and we're independent right now. And the end game is obviously to get the right record deal at the right time. But my question was, and I wrote a long diatribe about it.
Yes, it was. It was like the Magna Carta there, man.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
War and Peace. I just wanted to give all the details. So my question is this, and I know you don't have a crystal ball, but we are building momentum and a fan base and got about a 500,000.
You're doing background again. Get to the question, Lawrence. Question.
Yeah, yeah. So should we, keep on the current path and rock and keep on building the momentum? Or do you think it's a safer bet, since we're not that big yet, we don't have a big national footprint, to go ahead and make the switch to a different genre and just bend the sound to something more commercial?
Okay. Lawrence, can I ask a question to you? What's your business? How do you make your money? What's your business? What's your expertise?
I'm still in business. Okay, I own a tech company.
Sorry, a tech company. Okay.
Technology.
How good do you think I'd be at tech? If I enter tech tomorrow,
probably not that great.
What? I'd suck. I'd be the worst tech guy ever. Yeah. What arrogance and stupidity makes you think you can come into my business, right? And do my business, whereas I don't have the arrogant stupidity to think I'm coming to your business, yeah? So my immediate right. thing to say to you is, you're sinking $100,000 plus, right, into your kid's band, mm-hmm. right, which to me right. is absolute right. folly. It's like me sinking $100,000 into my kid's tech idea, yeah, when I don't know if it's a good or a bad idea, right. yeah.
So you're, which is you're not so, a whole lot.
So it's a crazy indulgence, yeah. And the only piece mm-hmm. of advice I can give you is, first of all, stop spending your own money. Second of all, mm-hmm. right, number two is, you cannot change your music to the market. Music is about passion. Music is about integrity. Music is about doing, you know, Sam Smith didn't suddenly say, oh yeah, you know, I remember when I first played, when Steve first played Greg Thompson, Stay With Me, and he's like, that's the most incredible record, but that tempo is going to be difficult for radio. That's the first thing that naturally the promo guy says. But at the same time, Greg said, mm-hmm. fuck, it's a, that record could also be a game changer. So I'm happy mm-hmm. to go there, but just to warn you, this could be more difficult than we anticipate. Well, obviously, post Saturday Night Live, that changed everything, and we had a live one, and Greg called me up and says, we're good. We don't need no remixes. We're good, guy. Let's just go for this. This is a game right. changer, right? So the truth of the matter is, we didn't compromise, right, the artist's integrity mm-hmm. to fit the market. And if you compromise the artist's integrity, right, then the artist has no mm-hmm. integrity and the public will see through that. And the truth of the matter is, mm-hmm. if an act comes in to see me and is a rock band, I don't halfway through the process say, yo, radio's playing more Maroon 5, or they're playing more Britney Spears, or they're playing more, Ellie Goulding, you need to make your music more like that. Because that's absolute stupidity. Because what I'm saying is, you know, what am I meant to do? Hide their tattoos? What am I meant to do? Hide what they're about? The artist has to be true to who they are, because, like I just said, the 20% is added on by the camera. You look 20% fatter. I'm way skinnier than this, by the way. But you know, if you're a liar, you're 20% bigger liar. If you're a nice guy, you're 20% a nicer guy. If you're a douche, you're 20% more of a douche. Maybe I look more of a douche today. But the truth is, you have to be honest. So jumping from right. one thing to another, what, as a tech company, you know, you start on one thing and then what, you flip to another thing because that's what the market's doing?
No.
You can't do that in music,
right?
Because people see through right. it, right? Now, you may mm-hmm. evolve, but the artist evolves, not the dad says, oh shit, I've noticed this or noticed that. You evolve. You evolve because, let me give an example. Skrillex was in a rock band signed to Atlantic, and he woke mm-hmm. up one day and decided, that's not where his passion was anymore, and he becomes Skrillex the DJ and is the second highest earning DJ in the world behind Calvin, from what mm-hmm. I understand from Forbes mm-hmm. magazine. But it wasn't the record label or his manager that said, yo, you need to get out of heavy metal and get into electronic music. It was his decision, right? And the minute right. we're making decisions right. for the artist will fail. Every time I've made a decision for the artist rather than guide, facilitate, influence, when I've turned around and said, no, you should change your entire being, then they're just some bullshit faker, right? And they're not really,
right.
they're not really doing it. So my attitude is two things. One, stop spending your own money. And two is actually say to your kids, what the fuck do you want to be? What the fuck do you like, right? But don't try and change it to make radio, because what will happen is you'll make a record and radio's already got very good records
by the time you get there.
Exactly. You got to go before the curve, not after the curve.
And see, and I'll say, Lawrence, just to weigh in on that too, you know, that's that whole idea of finding who you really are. And in any other business, you know, I think people can PowerPoint those businesses and make sense out of them. Every time I see that happening, it happens a lot in the tech space that intersects with our music business a lot, where I'll get these tech guys that are giving me these beautifully logical, reasonable PowerPoint presentations, and I always wind up going, that's so cute. Yeah. That thing, because it doesn't work that way. It's a business fueled by passion, and it defies market research, okay? The greatest artists were ahead of the parade, typically. The parade caught up to them, and then those people that are their sheep, not the lone wolves, start going, well, I want a piece of that. And when you do that, as Nick says, it kind of says, I'm new on your forehead. And I would give you one final bit of advice. The next best thing you could do is find your kid a real manager that's not his dad. And I'll just 100%. Say that with great experience, and I'll just tell you that. You may hate it, but it's true.
Yeah. I'm all good with that. You know, I understand that's going to come. And, you know, I've never said, you know, son, we're going this way. I mean, he didn't even call me dad when we do anything professionally. He's the one that started bending towards his sound. He's been offered in lots of different bands as a guitarist, and he was the one that started bending to the sound, and I started observing it more like a business instead of just a dad that was helping out.
Got it. Well, you know what? Great question. I'm glad you got through on the phone here today. Hopefully that helps you out a little bit. And best of luck to your son and his band there. Tell him to keep rocking. That's the way to go. All right.
Hey, thank you.
Okay, we are freaking, dude, we could go forever. You may have to come back and do a return engagement here, Nick. So before we leave with you, any more great questions in the chat room there, Kira?
Everyone just loves Nick and Nick.
Okay, fuck yeah. Why wouldn't they? You know, goddamn.
I'm not liking
it. You know, I wish he'd hold back a little bit. No, this is fucking awesome. Nick, before we go, I have this little section on the website called Ask Renman, but today you're here, and they get tired of hearing me, so we're going to take some more general type of questions here, so we're going to call this Ask Nick. See, we needed a clever graphic there, Code. A couple questions before you go. We had a question regarding networking. Let me just see if I got it right there. Hi, Nick and Steve. I will be moving to the fine city of Nashville to chase the dream this July. I'm a singer-songwriter in the vein of Ben Folds. I hope to be making a living touring with a full band of my own someday. What advice can you give me on getting connected once I get there? This is all about what we talked about the other night, networking and how important it is. The most important skill you said for exec and particularly is being able to talk about that whole idea of how a guy can connect with it. In this case, it's Nashville, but the same would be true. People move from Europe to London, your hometown.
My view on networking is quite interesting. I think there's a misconception, particularly in Americans. You know, people want to network me. Some guy tried to network me yesterday. I was literally like, what the fuck are you doing? This guy told me he was a singer-songwriter. Was a singer-songwriter. Now he's a producer-writer, and he's been he's being producing his own acts and this, that, and the other. And I said to him, "Well, have you had any hits?" He said, "No." I said, "Is there any interest in your acts?" He said, "No." I said to him, "Were you in a band before?" And he said, "Yes." I said, "Did you have a record deal?" He said, "I got offered record deals, but I didn't take them because I didn't get the right one from the right major." I said, "So you're literally waiting for like the perfect girl to come along before you have a date? That's just ridiculous. Not going to happen." And he said, "No, all I'm doing is networking with you." I said, "No, you're not. You're making a fool of yourself." Because the truth is, you don't go to a president of a record label to network with him. Because all the guys we talked about, you know, Richard was my boss. I earned the right to be in his sphere by coming up in the business, and I still look up to him. Steve, right, runs my American label. I still look up to him. But I earned the right when I was the president of the label to have a conversation with him. But all my pals, when Joe was the marketing assistant, I was a junior product manager, Christian was next door as a product manager, we became pals. So my thing is, when you're a singer-songwriter, you go to Nashville, find other singer-songwriters, right? Because one of them, one day, will be a big player. Because there has to be the next people coming up. So network amongst your peers. And don't network. Shag.
Yeah.
Friends. Drink. You know, I've not shagged any of the people we talked about, but you know what I mean? But live in that world, right? Yeah. Socialize in that world. Be in that world, right? And then what happens is, then people go off. The club I ran, so many people in there are in media. One girl is one of the most powerful people in TV, Sharon Powers. She's a big producer. She used to be like going crazy dancing on the bar with, you know, in her bra top, And now she's like this really important person in TV. And other guys are magazine editors. Other guys run blogs. One guy runs an amazing Peruvian restaurant. He used to be the warm-up DJ in London. If you ever come to London, ceviche, we should go there. Martin Morales, you're a lovely man. Right? He later sang Katie Tunstall, and he ran Disney Records in Europe. But he was just some young guy who DJ'd in my club. So the idea of networking in the American sense is bollocks. Networking is not networking. It's living, breathing in the space that you do, and through doing it you meet others who are equally ambitious doing it, and then one day they become your peers and you do not realize that you've networked because they're just some guy who drank beer with you till 4 a.m.
Well, it's funny, my oldest son here has watched so many of my friends come by over the years here. And so we've had some great little networking sessions out there. But you hit something that's very important for you folks that are watching out there. I think everybody wants to be your friend, right? And wants to network. When the truth is, you'd be better off doing just what you describe here. Making peers with other people in the business. My son brings over all his friends over here and we have a beer or whatever it might be. And it's fun, it's a great two-way exchange here. And over time, folks, you earn that right to those big players. But if you do have a lucky enough to get in front of Nick Raphaels of the world,
just be nice. Say, hey, I saw you on Renman Live. It was great. You know, just be nice because there's nothing. You don't have anything to ask. There's no business to be taken care of there. And that's what gets you guys like Nick are busy. They need to know, what do you want me to do, man?
And right? when you have something great, I'll come to you.
Thank you.
Right? And then you're in my network.
Yeah,
perfect. Because I won't forget that.
Yeah. One final question here before we go here. Where was it? A gentleman, okay, here by the name of Yaz. Or is this from Yasamin?
I think so.
This is Yasamin from New Zealand. It's a worldwide thing we got going. If an artist has independently released some music, then signs to a label, what determines, Nick, whether the already released music should be re-released under the major label? If it is, just the quality of music, and then would a label re-release a whole body of work, combined past EPs, etc.?
I'll give you a really good example on this one. Christian, who we mentioned earlier, who's another one of the guys I teamed up with. Mm. You know, you've got Joe, you've got Steve Barnett, you've got Richard Griffiths, but Christian's another one. Oh, I set a label up in 1996. Mm. When we left working together, the first thing he signed was David Gray. David Gray had released White Ladder himself. Mm. He'd been dropped by Virgin, he'd been dropped by EMI, he'd had two record deals, and him and his manager mortgaged his house to make White Ladder. And he released White Ladder, and it was, I think, still one of the biggest selling albums of all time in Ireland. They own everything in Ireland. Mm. And Christian, because he knew him through Orbital, licensed the record. Mm. Did some radio mixes for the radio and re-released the entire record because the record was undeniable, mm-hmm. right? The radio needed better mixes sonically, mm-hmm. but everything else, the way the artist said it, they fixed that, mm. but didn't fix the version on the album because mm. the album sounded good together the way it was. Yeah. It was slightly lo-fi. Uh-huh. That record sold 6.8 million copies. It's going through 3 million in the UK. Mm. It's a humongously mm. successful record. But it's the same record that they made mortgaging in the house and doing the thing. So if the music's good enough and it's released independently, that is a showcase for mm. what's going to come yeah. after.
And by the way, when you have something that hasn't been heard, it's yeah. brand new for everybody to mm. listen. We've got another one right here. Nick, this is from Majuscule Media. With all the drama unfolding around Tidal, your friend Jay-Z, who's feeling what it's like to be an entrepreneur instead of a rock star. Entrepreneurs get nasty letters from their customers. With all the drama unfolding around Tidal, are the labels starting to really take another look at their streaming and digital sales contracts? With these channels turning into a prime income source, it seems to be an area every artist is frequently concerned with, especially when deciding to go independent. What are the labels doing to keep up with the digital age?
It's a really weird question for me. I don't care. I'm not interested. I'm signing the act. I'm making the content or facilitating the making of the mm. content. I have absolute trust in my parent company, in the people that do mm. it on our behalf, who work mm. for Lucian out here. And what they decide, right, will mm. be what happens for my artists. Mm. And the truth is, I'm completely agnostic. Mm-hmm. Anyone who's willing to pay for music, I applaud them. Anyone who's willing to invest money in people who are going to pay for music, whether it be streaming, whether it be downloading, mm-hmm. whether it be buying physical, I applaud them and I thank them for creating channels for us to sell our music through mm-hmm. and channels. I thank every radio mm-hmm. station who plays our music. Mm-hmm. I thank every person who puts it on a sync. Mm-hmm. But in terms of what Tidal means or what Beats means or whatever, I don't have an opinion because yeah. the truth of the matter is, like I said when I wasn't being rude before, I go into my world every day and we have five mm. artists signed to label. Mm-hmm. And when we have those five artists signed to label, I'm thinking every hour that I'm allowed, mm-hmm. that I'm not doing jujitsu or doing yoga mm-hmm. or having dinner with friends, I'm thinking, how can I make this work? Mm-hmm. How can I better where we're at mm-hmm. on these artists? Mm-hmm. I'm staying in touch with my artists, I'm staying in touch with my managers. I've never ever talk to anyone. I go to meetings where it's discussed mm. and I sit there and I literally zone out. I'm like the kid at school who's in geography.
It's so funny to hear you say that because you're very much a big picture thinker. And the truth of the matter is if you get the music right, you know, the everything rest of it will yeah. follow. And the greatest tragedy in the music business, in my humble opinion, is that if a great artist is never heard, a great performance is never seen, you know, a great song is never experienced, That's the tragedy. This whole discussion about streaming and Spotify and this and that begs the point or loses the point that getting music heard is the most difficult thing after it's been made. And for people like Nick and even myself, who I tend not to worry about those details as much, that's the mission, is to make sure that great artists, great songs, and great performers are seen and heard around the world. And so that's what it's all about. Folks, we're coming to the end here. We've got to get Nick back to his next meeting where he can make some money here. First off, I want to thank all the folks that are viewing here today. If we didn't get to your question today, try to post them online. That's the best way to get them in here. I want to say thank you to my wonderful crew back there, Cody Romnes and Kira O'Neill, who make this happen. Without them, I absolutely could not do it. I want to thank Joseph for all that work on revving up the social media to make sure people are showing up. But more importantly, I want to thank you, Mr. Nick Raphael, for being here and sharing your wisdom here with your inimitable English. I love English, folks, if you haven't figured that out today. I am the Renman. This little program is called Renman Live. Well, stay tuned to our social media. We'll let you know when the next show is happening. It's been a pleasure having you. We'll see you again soon.